Hi, I'm Ward Stair, and I'm thrilled to be coming to the Bellingham Festival of Music this summer. We've got a fantastic program in store for you. We start off with Brahms variations on a theme of Haydn, then Barber, Knoxville, summer of 1915, and finally, Mahler's Fourth Symphony. All three of these pieces have a few things in common. For one, they were all inspired by other works of art. In the case of the Barber and the Mahler, it was poetry. In the case of the Brahms, it was Haydn, or so he thought. More on that later. All three are scored for chamber orchestra. All three, in one way or another, evoke nature. The Barber and the Mahler both tell a story through the eyes of a child, which is very charming. And most importantly, both the Barber and the Mahler call for a soprano soloist. And I'm thrilled to welcome Andreana Tschutschmann to the stage. She is an extraordinary artist, and I cannot wait to hear how she performs both of these pieces. All three composers were giants in their field, and all three were absolutely at the top of their game when they wrote these pieces. So you're really in for a treat, ladies and gentlemen. I think it'll be a memorable, moving musical evening. Our first piece on the program is Brahms' Variations on a Theme of Haydn, a title which unfortunately is not altogether correct. We now know that the theme that Brahms based this piece on is not in fact written by Haydn, or I should say we're 99.9% sure that that's the case. But at the time, Brahms thought that it was a piece of Haydn's that he had discovered, and he was really excited about it. The reason that it was discovered in the first place is that Brahms was hanging out in the library at the Vienna Philharmonic with his friend, who was the librarian, and he was showing him some pieces that he had come across. And there was one in particular that was written for wind ensemble that caught Brahms' attention. And the reason it caught his attention is because the first two phrases were not organized in the typical four bars or eight bars, but rather in five bars, which at this point in history, in musical history, was actually kind of unusual. We see that a lot more commonly now, but a five-bar phrase back in Brahms' day, that really caught his attention. And the librarian said, yes, well, this is a piece that was written by Haydn. And we now know that the reason it was attributed to Haydn is because the publishers were always trying to, you know, increase their sales. A common way to do that back then was to take a piece by a lesser composer and falsely attribute it to a more famous composer in the hopes that more people would buy it. So that's what we think happened. And actually in 1951, the Haydn Society officially rejected the notion that the melody was in fact Haydn. So I think we can put that to bed, but the name stuck, and it's a catchy name for the piece anyway, so we'll just keep calling it the Brahms Haydn Variations. But anyway, back to the music. This five-note theme proved to be very fertile ground for Brahms for his variations. And his first iteration of the piece was actually for piano. It was for four-hand piano, so two players playing together. And it's a really wonderful composition technically and in a lot of other ways too. But the technique that Brahms employs is really quite stunning. The counterpoint in particular is really noteworthy. He was very meticulous about his technique throughout his entire life. In fact, one of my favorite stories about Brahms is that apparently every morning before breakfast he would get up and do counterpoint exercises. Can you believe that? Brahms, the great master composer, still getting up doing his counterpoint exercises before breakfast. It shows his dedication. It shows how passionate he was about his craft. And I think it's wonderful. It comes through in a lot of his pieces, but I think especially in this one. So after he wrote the piano version of this piece and decided to set it for full orchestra, he didn't really change the musical structure at all, but of course the orchestration is really magical. The piece itself consists of the theme and then eight variations and then a finale, which in and of itself is a theme and variation. So, you know, it's just like innovation on top of innovation on top of innovation. It's a very, very creative piece, and it shows off orchestral color, I think, in a really beautiful way. Now, this can be challenging for an orchestra, even a great orchestra, not because the passages are particularly virtuosic, but because musically you always have to be listening for where the melody's coming from and where it's going, because, you know, when it was originally written for just piano, two pianists can hear one another, you know, fairly clearly because the timbre is consistent throughout. It's just the piano sonority. But when you expand that to the full orchestra, then all of a sudden the second oboe has to be listening to the third horn, and the cellos have to be listening to the bassoons, and the melodies are always crisscrossing one another and weaving in and out of the orchestral texture in a really, really interesting way. And if this piece is performed well, you should hear a lot of vibrant color throughout every movement. It's really quite stunning. Even though this piece we now know is not written, or the, not the piece, excuse me, the theme is not written by Haydn. Remember, Brahms thought that it was at the time. So he throws in a little Haydn quote at the very end. That's actually the only part of this whole work that has anything to do with Haydn. And Brahms quotes the Clock Symphony right towards the end. If you know the Haydn Clock Symphony, you'll hear it. It's shortly before the very, very, very end of the finale. Just a nice little nod, tip of the hat, to Haydn from Brahms. But overall, the piece is, it's got a country, sort of rustic, bucolic feel about it. Brahms wrote it on his summer vacation when he went out to the countryside, as he often did. He loved to be in nature, and it definitely has that flavor to it. It's also got some nostalgia in it. It's very charming. It's at times grand, and it's just a really beautiful piece, and it's like a masterclass in compositional technique, and it's a piece that orchestras know and love to play, and it's a piece that I think is a great way to open this program, and I think you're really going to like it. This is just lovely. Sitting on a porch at the end of a day in summer evening, rocking gently, enjoying the warm summer air. It's really perfect. And this is exactly the atmosphere that Barber captures in the beginning of his piece, Knoxville, summer of 1915. He was inspired by a poem by James Agee with the same title, Knoxville, summer of 1915. And the piece, Barber's piece, begins a little more than halfway through with a line, quote, "It has become that time of evening when people sit on their porches, rocking gently and talking gently," end quote. It's really an amazing piece. Barber is somehow able to capture this perfect little slice of Americana and this moment in time through music that also is in the AG poem too. It's a perfect marriage of the two. It's really extraordinary. And when you think about it, it was a perfect fit for Barber because he really had all of these things in his DNA. He was from a small town, just like James AG. In fact, both men had a lot in common. They were about the same age, from a small town, so they had, you know, shared values and experiences. AG was inspired actually by the death of his father in 1915 when he was only 6 years old. And as it turns out, when Barber was writing his version of the piece, both his aunt and his father were gravely ill. Barber would dedicate Knoxville to the memory of his father. The piece is really extraordinary in the way it uses the music to help tell the story. It's a technique that's sometimes called text painting or word painting, and you know, just like these cars we hear driving by, you can hear that the voice will say, "A loud auto," or maybe that was the quiet auto, I don't know. Oh, here comes there's the loud one, there's the quiet one. But you can hear, the point is you can hear the cars going by the porch in the orchestra. And the opening, for example, the gentle rocking music, you'll hear the flowing eighth notes in the flute and the gentle, relaxed, rhythmical underpinning in the orchestra, which is just perfect for sitting, rocking, casual conversation. There's also a scene after the loud cars passing by, which we're hearing an example of right now. You'll hear a streetcar rattling through the town very raucously and making a bunch of noise. And there's a technique that Barber writes for in the strings called pizzicato glissando, which is meant to represent the sparks on the antenna at the top of the streetcar as it roars through town. Very cool. There's also a moment in the poem where the family goes out on the lawn, spreads quilts out, and sits and gazes up at the stars. And again, the music is just so perfectly suited to this image. It's very calm, it's beautiful, lyrical, intimate. And the child says, quote, "All my people are larger bodies than mine." It's such an interesting thing to say, and the way it's phrased is just a perfect, I think it's what you might expect to hear, and only an innocent young child would say something like that, and it's hugely charming, and just, you know, such a beautiful observation. And when you hear the way it's set in the music, I think you'll agree, your heart will absolutely melt. The whole piece is not all just peace and beauty. There is a little bit of, you know, conflict toward the end. The themes shift away from casual observation and relaxed summer life to more philosophical questions and even issues of sorrow and trouble and, in fact, death, which, as I said, was an important element for both A.G. and Barber in the writing of the poem and the music. So that the music really intensifies underneath those lines and comes to quite a powerful climax before ebbing again to this more relaxed atmosphere that permeates most of the piece. As we get toward the end, we also have an image of the quintessential, you know, a child being put to bed image where, you know, the child goes in and falls gently asleep, and the music, again, suits that perfectly. It's very gentle, it's very quiet. And then after the child has fallen asleep, the piece ends with kind of a question. It's a little bit open-ended. The question of, who am I? What am I? Will my home, can it ever tell me who I am? And I think the answer in the poem anyway is no. So it really actually leaves you in a very thought-provoking way. I think it's a great way to end the first half of our program. I think it sets up the Mahler beautifully. And I think I think A.G.'s poem is powerful, and I think Barber's music is just divine. And the marriage of the two is extraordinary, and it's something that I hope will affect you and make you think and really tug at your heartstrings like it does mine.
The first thing you'll notice about Mahler's Fourth Symphony is its size. It's much smaller than you would expect when you think of a Mahler symphony. It's smaller in scale, it's smaller in the orchestra itself. He doesn't even use trombones or tuba, for example. Yet, it's surprisingly intricate, amazingly well-crafted, and as we know, a lot of times great things come in small packages. So, don't let that turn you off. This is an amazing symphony. It's one of my favorites, and it's actually a pivotal work in the evolution of Mahler's compositions for a lot of reasons that we'll kind of get into later. You could spend months, weeks talking about this symphony, but for today's purposes, we're just going to dive into a couple highlights and key points about each of the movements. So let's start with the first movement. Right off the bat, you'll hear something that can be kind of a red herring for the listener, and that is the sleigh bells. Now, the reason I'm calling it a red herring is that when you think of sleigh bells, what's the first thing you think about? Maybe some winter scene, you think about snow, horse coming through the, you know, the wintry wonderland, cozying up to the fire, etc., etc., etc. It kind of conjures up a lot of different images. But if you're going down that route mentally when you hear the sleigh bells at the beginning of the symphony, that's the wrong direction. Mahler tells us that he actually intends that to be the bells on the end of a jester's hat, which means it's supposed to be funny. This whole first movement, and the whole symphony in fact, was actually composed originally with a humoresque in mind, meaning that it should be comic, it should have funny elements to it. So I think that's really important to keep in mind as you listen, particularly to the first movement. But don't let those sleigh bells throw you off and think that we're going, you know, to grandma's house at Christmas, because That's not it at all. Mahler does actually insert a lot of really sophisticated musical jokes. Those of you who are Mahler enthusiasts or musicologists will enjoy how he plays with the sonata allegro form, for example. It's not quite what it's supposed to be, but he sort of makes you think it's going to be 1 second and then it's not. He also plays with the style a little bit. He kind of evokes Mozart, Haydn, Schubert, Beethoven, not only in the size of the orchestra itself, but also in the way he writes melody, the way he writes ornamentation, things like that. So there's another little inside joke there for you. the overall kind of atmosphere of the first movement has been, there have been people who have put forth lots of lofty ideas about how it's supposed to represent innocence versus experience and other things kind of like that. And that, of course, is all valid. There's nothing wrong with thinking about it that way. But I like to think of it in a little more simpler terms. I think the first movement is just about life. I think it's about everyday life, life in the here and now with all its blemishes, all its chaos, all its energy, frenetic energy, diversity. It's really a kaleidoscopic movement. It's kind of like a mosaic. It's kind of like a conversation at times even, complete with rude interruptions and people going off in different directions with diverging thoughts and then, oh, coming back to what they were talking about before. It's really amazing to follow it, and it's, like I said, it's kind of got all these things spinning at once. So you'll hear the orchestra making all sorts of abrupt tempo changes and diving off in different directions, and I think that's very exciting. And as I said, to me, that just represents a really busy, diverse, vibrant life in, you know, in the here and now, modern life. It's a very modern movement in that regard, if you look at it that way. Now, here's where we get into where it's a pivotal work for Mahler in terms of his style, because this is where the polyphony comes in. He's kind of playing with how he works with polyphony in his compositions. And what he does here in the Fourth Symphony is really, it matures in the Fifth, Sixth, and Seventh Symphony and beyond in Mahler's work. So listen for that and listen for how he treats polyphony in this first movement in particular. And it's kind of a foreshadowing of what's to come. It's really exciting. There are lots of little morsels to listen for in the first movement, themes that are part of the last movement, which he wrote first, that will be kind of hinted at, that you'll hear later on in the symphony. So listen for that as well. There's too many of them to name right now, but the most obvious one is those sleigh bells, which are not sleigh bells on a horse drawn carriage. They are bells on the end of a jester's cap. So don't forget that. Now let's go on to the second movement, which is probably the most hotly debated in terms of what it's about. one thing that's important to remember is that Mahler really didn't want people to look at this as programmatic music. He didn't want you to be thinking of a specific thing. He actually went to great lengths to try to keep that out of the press and out of people's minds when they were listening to his symphonies. But he wasn't successful, especially in the second movement, because we have first-hand accounts of his protege Bruno Walter, his widow Alma Mahler, even Mengelberg, who is himself a great conductor, who would sit in rehearsals and take copious notes on what Mahler said as he was conducting. And so we have a couple different ideas here that have emerged over the years. One is that the second movement is about Freund Hein, who is this character in children's literature in Germany who kind of represents the devil, who's playing the fiddle in this demonic way and leading us towards death. And the other idea that's come actually from Alma Mahler is that she says as Mahler was composing this, he was kind of fascinated with this painting. The painter was called Böcklin, I think. Hope I'm getting that name right. And the painting is a self-portrait, and it shows the devil fiddling on the shoulder of the painter and sort of, you know, enticing him towards wherever. So those two images really kind of came into the consciousness about this movement, and a lot of people think that that's what it is. People call it a Totentanz, people call it a danse macabre sometimes. It's also sometimes called a scherzo. But I think all of those things, while they definitely have valid elements to them, are not as important to think about. I think you should focus on the fact that it's really a Landler. It's a country dance, country song. It's rustic, it's bucolic, and yes, there's this fiddler who plays a prominent role and uses a cool technique called scordatura. So what that means is you'll see the concertmaster with two different violins, one tuned normally and the other tuned a whole step higher. And what that does is it gives the violin a more kind of strident sound. It really pierces through the texture in a way that's different from what you might be accustomed to hearing in a solo violin. So this kind of gives it that edge, which also lends itself to this image of it being the devil's violin. Whether it's really supposed to be that, I guess we'll never know for sure. But in the overall arc of the symphonic kind of story, if you will, it does make sense, because if the first movement is about life in the here and now, in all its vibrancy, maybe the second movement is a little bit autumnal almost. It's kind of like you're getting towards the end of your life, starting to think about mortality, starting to think about what the end might look like, and maybe off in the distance there is someone fiddling you, beckoning you towards whatever comes next. And what comes next in the symphony is the third movement, which is definitely the focal point of the entire piece, and it is stunningly beautiful. It's the longest of the movements, and at first you may be reminded of the slow movement of Beethoven's Ninth Symphony, and you'd be right. It's very similar, but it's not exactly the same in its form. Here again, Mahler plays with our kind of musicological or compositional purist sensibilities. It's not a perfect double theme and variations. It's a little bit different, as only Mahler could write it. There are a lot of great moments in the third movement, but the one that trumps them all is this amazing depiction of the opening of the gates of heaven in a blaze of glory in E major. That happens right toward the end of the movement. And right after this intense climax, you'll also hear the Ewigkeit motif, which again lends itself to this feeling of eternal peace and rest and tranquility. It's a stunningly beautiful movement, and I think, again, first movement, let's look at it through this story arc, life in the here and now. Second movement, maybe getting closer to death. Those first two movements are really about earthly things, life on earth, you know, humanity, in a basic way. And then the third movement is a little bit more spiritual, and you'll definitely hear that in the melodies and in the textures and sonorities. The very end of the movement, Mahler sets us up absolutely perfectly for the finale by ending not on a tonic but on a dominant, so he really just serves it up, and then we seamlessly go into the fourth movement, which is what we've been waiting for this whole time, because remember, Mahler wrote the fourth movement first. And this is where the soprano joins us as well, and she sings the heavenly life as seen through the eyes of a child. And it's an absolutely beautiful way to end the symphony, and it's really cool. It kind of has that like German children's fairy tale vibe about, I think, Brothers Grimm. You know, there are big animals being led to the slaughter willingly because they want to feed everybody, and the angels are baking the bread, and everybody's singing and dancing and having a great time. It's a really, it's got a lot of quirks about it, but it's also a really cool thing to think about, just looking at a child's vision of heaven. And one thing that's important to remember is that Mahler specifically said that the soprano should not perform with any added affectation, because he didn't want it to seem like a parody. So there's a fine line between parody and humoresque. So it's light, it's got to have humor to it, but it's also... it's serious, because we're talking about a child's vision of heaven. And my favorite moment in the whole last movement is the beginning of the last stanza, where the soprano sings, "Kein Musik ist ja nicht auf Erden," which means there's no music like this anywhere on earth. And I would have to agree, in a sense, although we are performing it, of course, on earth, so it's not literal, but it's a very, very beautiful moment. And again, here Mahler uses tonality to really reinforce that, because he ends in E major. Most of the last movement's been in G major, but if you look further back in the symphony, a lot of the strife and conflict has been in E minor. So what Mahler does almost subconsciously here is he washes away all of that darkness and negativity in this beautiful, blissful bath of E major. And the piece ends with the soprano talking about the angels, evoking everyone to rouse the senses to joy. And that's how the piece ends. It's a really beautiful way to end the symphony. I think it's a great way to end the program. Music, good food, dancing, singing, joy. And I certainly hope that this entire program brings you all a lot of joy, and I hope that that joy stays with you long after the performance is finished.